Hello.
Well, I often start this program with a question to you, Ken Sensei.
Yes.
And I'm not going to change it. I know you're very fond of music, but do you play any musical instrument, or is there any particular instrument that you like?
Here you go again, Hiram-san, trying to humiliate me in front of everybody. You know perfectly well I don't play any musical instrument, but I did spend about 10 years practicing, and I say practicing the piano, but I'm afraid not with any great result. And as soon as I could escape from it, I did.
Well, it's a very similar case with me, too. I practiced piano for 2 years, but I quit as soon as possible. But I'm very fond of koto. And I took a few lessons in it. That was my own choice when I was quite young. But I don't play it anymore because I don't have the instrument with me anymore.
Where is your instrument?
Well, when I was in the States, it was too expensive to ship it back to Japan.
Really?
So I gave it to the school where I was studying.
Oh, how interesting. You left your koto behind.
Yes. That was my Japanese gift. But do you like koto music?
Yes, I do. I'm very fond of the koto, and to me it reminds me of a Western harp.
Yes.
I find the music very pleasant indeed. But I do like it in a Japanese ambiance, which may be asking for too much all the time. But, you know, I like it played in a traditional Japanese setting.
As you know, koto is very popular even today, together with shamisen. Although I think shamisen is a bit more difficult to play than koto, at least for the beginners. But today we are going to introduce an American lady who is a koto player, and she plays koto professionally as an accredited teacher of Yamada School of Koto. Her name is Lynn Wakabayashi.
Hello there.
Thank you for coming along today.
Nice of you to come. Can we call you Lynn? Lynn?
Please.
Wakabayashi is such a mouthful, isn't it? Even
it
for
is indeed. Now, Lynn, you look far more Japanese than I am in your beautiful kimono.
Thank you very much.
She does.
Actually, I'm a sansei, a third-generation Japanese-American, and I was born in America, born and raised in America. Naturally, my nationality is also American.
You sound like a true blue American.
Well, of course, we are very much interested in knowing why you became involved in koto and your background. Now, could you tell us in the beginning how you were raised in America?
Certainly. I was born in 1955. That's 10 years after the war with Japan had ended. And my father was working in the Department of Defense in Washington, D.C. So we lived in the suburbs of Washington. And my parents would often take me down to downtown Washington to see the Capitol or Lincoln Memorial. Often also this type of typical scene of cherry blossom during cherry blossom season is really beautiful.
It's very pretty, doesn't it?
Yes. And we'd also often take bike rides along the Potomac or the CNO Canal, which runs parallel to the Potomac.
Is that you in the distance there, Lynn?
I wish it were. And we'd often spend our weekends that way. But my father and mother are both Japanese American Nisei, and they both work for the government, and naturally they're born and raised in America, so they're quite thoroughly American in idea and behavior. And as a matter of fact, my father came to Japan during the occupation as a member of the American forces.
Really?
Yes.
Was that his first visit to Japan?
As a matter of fact, it was.
My goodness, that must have been quite an experience.
Yes, I should think so.
But as I said before, we lived in Rockville, Maryland, which is about a 30-minute drive away from downtown Washington, D.C. So 30 minutes means 30 miles or so.
Here we have a map.
Yes.
We have rudimentary
fashion. Yes.
And there you are, living in the pink house, not the white house.
Yes. Rockville is a very typical middle-class suburban area.
And I believe that's you with your American friends.
Yes.
and my friends.
I was raised just like any other American. And I'm sure you know that there are very few Japanese or Asians, as a matter of fact, on the East Coast.
On the East Coast, yes. So you're kind of rare birds,
yes,
aren't you, there?
In Washington, D.C. also. So all my playmates or my schoolmates were Caucasian. And I must say that at one point in my school days, I was positive that I was just as Caucasian as all my other classmates were. So that's how American I was.
You weren't peering at yourself in the mirror and saying, I don't look quite like them. Anyway.
Yes. And
no, I was just going to say, and you, of course, presumably behaved in the same way as your colleagues in school did.
I was the typical tomboy, actually. And yes, yes,
yes, yes, a very good
like
example.
An Indian
actually, I'm showing off my fine tennis form, but I enjoyed sports very much and ready to climb any tree that was available.
You liked the tennis so much you played in the house.
Yes, average tomboy. But I also enjoyed music, Western music. I played the flute and the oboe. Well, I gave the oboe a go, but unfortunately I didn't produce anything, any good results, actually.
Perhaps you didn't have enough power in your lungs to blow, was it, or was it the lips that you need for the oboe?
Both, actually.
Yes.
But I enjoyed popular music very much. For instance, soul music or folk music, rock music. So I must say I must have been a very typical American teenager.
You're not really a Beatle generation girl, are you?
No,
you're a bit too young for the Beatles thing.
Yes, I think I'm the generation after.
You just missed them, right?
But isn't it a typical phenomenon among youngsters all over the world to enjoy American music?
Yes. I think American popular music reflects not just music, but American popular thought in general. And that may be what is so appealing, perhaps.
Yes, and after all, America is such a mixture of different cultures. It's not in the least bit surprising, is it, that American popular music should appeal to many different nationalities?
True,
I would have thought so, anyway. Yes. Well, did you, or were you aware of the developing changes in American music? Perhaps you were.
Yes, I could feel them, yes, during my teens and my 20s. This is a summer concert in, held along the mall, I believe, well, no, along the banks of the Potomac in Washington, D.C. And I believe this was held during July 4th, Independence Day. These are held every year annually. Well, they're held every year in Washington in the summertime. And I believe this is the Marine Corps band performing.
Did you like this kind of music, Lynn?
Yes, I enjoyed it quite a bit.
It struck a patriotic chord.
Yes.
I thought your father liked it more than you did.
Actually, yes, my father would take me down quite often.
Yes, indeed. And this is July the 4th celebration. And did you feel, listening to some music like this, oh, I'm an American, or I belong to this country?
Unfortunately, no. I didn't have that deep a reaction, that strong a reaction, because I felt that, well, I was born and raised in America.
And yes, and you weren't sitting there saying, I'm an American. You never thought about it,
yes,
I suppose.
Yes, unfortunately, I wasn't that conscious of my American.
That's like you, Hiromi, saying you didn't sit there as a child saying, I'm Japanese.
Did That's
you?
Very
you
true.
Took it for granted.
Yes. Yeah. But as I said earlier, my parents are typically middle-class Americans, even though our family is of Japanese descent. And so we used English at home, and naturally we had an American education. So the ideas of democracy and freedom, I'm sorry.
Strongly.
Yes, we're not. Yes.
But tell me, your parents presumably could speak Japanese, couldn't they, if they wanted to?
Actually, I think they had to communicate in Japanese as children, in Japanese as children. But my mother now won't speak Japanese. She can understand what's being said to her, but won't speak on her own. Yes.
Interesting.
Lincoln Memorial, isn't it?
Yes, the Lincoln Memorial. Very, very impressive.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, this is stirring stuff.
Yes.
Make all Americans proud.
And July the 4th fireworks.
Yes.
The traditional fireworks display. Mm-hmm. Reminds me of Japan.
That's supposed to be typically American, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, well, well. Anyway, we've been looking at Washington, D.C., July the 4th, and stirring martial music. Mm-hmm. But how, Lynn, did you begin to become aware of things Japanese, your ethnic cultural background?
There are a few Japanese Americans in Washington, D.C., mm-hmm. and so there's a group, a club of Japanese Americans, uh-huh. mainly a social club, I believe. Mm-hmm. And we would get together occasionally with them. And there, we also had a bit of contact with Japanese nationals, mm-hmm. Particularly people involved in the embassy.
Yeah, yes.
We would go down to the embassy in Washington every year on New Year's morning, mm-hmm. and they would have an elaborate osechi ryori feast set out for everyone.
Did you like the food?
Yes, that was quite impressive.
Really?
Yes.
First time you got raw fish, was it?
actually, no.
Had it at home, I expect, yes.
Yes. And in fact, I had a number of koto lessons at the embassy, too.
Really?
In a room quite similar to this one. Perhaps it was this one, in fact.
Mm, beautiful room, beautiful embassy.
Yes.
Could anybody take a koto lesson at the Japanese embassy?
No, actually, there was a small group of kotoists in Washington, mm-hmm. and we would get together there.
Mm-hmm. Now, you were playing in the, excuse me, you were playing in, say, in the embassy, but when did you actually start to practice the koto? I mean, at what age and when and why?
I first began when I was six. And my grandmother was teaching me.
That's your grandmother.
Yes,
there,
that's
isn't
my
it?
Grandmother. Mm-hmm. When my grandmother went to America, she took her koto along with her, mm-hmm. and I think she's so proud of her heritage, mm-hmm. that she wanted to try to transmit some of her culture or mm-hmm. cultural heritage to her grandchildren because she loved it so much herself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Were you happy to have this opportunity?
At first, I was quite against the whole idea. Why am I being forced to learn this strange instrument?
You didn't like the sound.
I didn't like going through a 30-minute lesson, perhaps.
Well, that's
understandable. The typical, yes, reaction. But
so, was your attitude towards Japanese culture at this time very sort of offhand?
I think so. Yes. Although I had a limited exposure to Japanese culture, I think it was extremely limited. Mm-hmm. And so it still was, Japan was a very distant, kind of exotic place still for me. Mm-hmm.
And how about college days? What did you do there? When did you go?
When I went to college, I decided that I was definitely more interested in pursuing studies in Japanese. So
uh-huh.
I majored, mm-hmm. yes, majored in East Asian Studies, which is an area studies.
At which mm-hmm. college?
At Wesleyan University. It's mm-hmm. a small liberal arts college in Connecticut.
Uh-huh.
And I also majored in music, Japanese music.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's surprising to me that a small college or university of that nature on the East Coast would mm-hmm. have a Japanese music
yes,
course.
Indeed. Yes,
indeed.
Yes.
Actually, Wesleyan was quite well known for its ethnomusicology department.
Really?
Uh-huh. And they would invite artists from all over the world to come and mm-hmm. teach performance.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I went to Wesleyan. And in fact, yes, this is...
You graduating, is
yes,
it?
Yes, my graduation picture from Wesleyan.
Uh-huh. And is that your parents and your grandmother?
Yes, mm-hmm. my grandmother to my left and my parents.
Uh-huh. Looking very resplendent in your red graduation gown. Uh-huh.
Yes.
Ah, but this is a very different graduation. <isn't it? laughs>
Yes, after graduating from the American University, I received a Momusho scholarship and came to the Fine Arts University in mm-hmm. Tokyo Geidai. And this past April, I received my master's in musicology, specializing in Japanese music.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting indeed.
Now, I'm interested in your language, too. I know you speak very good Japanese. Did you learn it in college or before you entered college?
I learned it in college, actually. Unlike the Nikkei one, the West Coast, there weren't enough of us to actually have a substantial Japanese language school.
Yes.
And sometimes my parents would try to start something up, but it would usually end in failure.
Well, you put me to shame. It's graceful. Well, I think it's extremely interesting that you were raised as a typical American, mm-hmm. yet you gradually became aware of your, I keep saying ethnic, of your Japanese ancestral culture, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you've experienced both, Lynn. You were brought up completely as an American, and yet you come here and you gradually become interested in Japanese cultural things. Now, do you see these two things as separate, or are they blended together?
I think the Japanese approach to music and the American
music,
approach to music are really quite different. Actually, when I was at Wesleyan, I took a year's absence in order to come to Tokyo to become an uchideshi to Ichimura Ayano sensei, who was a leading Yamada performer. And that was quite an experience for me. I would get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and clean the house, make meals, serve tea, carry my teacher's shamisen to her performances or recordings, whatever, and also practice.
My goodness, it doesn't seem to me as though you've had much time for practicing.
Yes,
you said you got up at six. What time was bedtime?
10 or so. Early rise, early.
So not much time for gallivanting around the bright lights of Tokyo.
No.
But didn't you resent the fact that you're forced to clean the house, serve tea, etc.? I mean, didn't you feel that that has nothing to do with music?
At first, yes. I questioned what the connection
was.
Yes, the value, actually, of cleaning house and while you're supposedly an apprentice. But I began to realize that this training, rigorous training, is not only a physical training, but also a mental training. And the discipline that you attain, or when you're going through all this housework and chores, also is reflected in your music.
This is similar, isn't it, Hiromi-san, to what we've heard about martial arts, isn't it?
Yes.
That it's not just a matter of being skillful at wielding the stick or whatever the spiritual training and discipline that you mentioned, which is reflected in your music.
I must say that one good point about the apprenticeship system is that if the uchideshi is not dedicated enough or motivated enough, he will drop out.
One way of weeding out the weaklings. Well, it looks pretty strong.
Agree with me, Lynn?
Yes, I think it is a very strenuous apprenticeship. So that anyone who is able to go through that really is a plus for them, I think, in the future. Not only a mental plus, but also actually a practical plus.
Yeah.
There's also sorts of practical training also that you're able to.
And you're listening to your teacher a great deal, aren't you?
Yes, actually, that was perhaps the most rewarding part of being an uchideshi, to be in your teacher's home all the time and listening all the time to that music.
Well, it seems to me that the koto music has a close connection with the way Japanese people, Hiromi-san, perceive sounds.
That's very true. We find insects and birds and rustling leaves quite musical. But I suppose Westerners don't have that reaction, do they, Lynn?
Well, it's difficult now for me to answer your question because at this point I've had training in Japanese music and the Japanese way of interpreting sounds. But I must say that when I first came to Japan, and was studying with Ichimura sensei, who is a student of Nakanomishima Kinichi sensei, that I realized that there really was quite a large gap in between the way that she perceived sounds and I did.
Yes, well, only the other day somebody said to me, do foreigners listen to the sound of insects as we do in Japan, and I'd never thought about it, Lynn, before this was put to me. And we don't really, do we?
We hear, I think, but don't really listen. Yes.
And of course, in this day and age, with people living in huge cities like this, of course, I suppose it's disappearing even in Japan, isn't it?
Yes, indeed.
Yes, I think it's really virtually impossible for me to intuitively listen, actually, to natural sounds as music. But I think younger Japanese, too, are in the same position that I am. For one thing, their environment is changing so much that they don't have an opportunity to hear and appreciate these sounds.
Did you ever have moments of despair when you thought you would never be able to fit into this cultural picture?
I think I'll be left out.
But it seems to me, Lynn, you're trying to say that a sort of Japanese identity with music or in music is not permanent, that it is changing.
Yes, I think it is constantly changing. It has been and will continue to. I think the value, or one's values towards music are created and changed by one's environment and by time.
Now that's an interesting point, because especially after the Meiji Restoration, the Japanese people tried to westernize Japanese music. That means, to introduce Western music to Japanese music. And in the field of koto, of course, we cannot forget the name of Miyagi Ichio, who tried to introduce Western techniques into koto, and also he composed quite a few pieces inspired by Western concept. Now, what do you think of such approaches, Lynn?
Actually, when I first began studying koto, I was quite attracted to these westernized koto pieces, because I felt I could deal with them, I could appreciate them better with my background. But now, having studied and gained more experience, I'm beginning to, I think, appreciate the austerity of traditional Japanese music.
You use an interesting word there, austerity. Is that really what one means? Is it the simplicity, the lack of richness or decoration or
something? Yes, I think it's difficult to put into one word, but...
You're going to say shibui.
Yes, I'm going to say shibui.
Do Japanese people find it odd, Lynn, or strange that you are studying the koto?
Yes. In fact, the foreign students studying music at Geidai, virtually all of us have the same reaction, or reacted to the same way. Why are you studying traditional Japanese music? So younger people aren't interested in Japanese music. Why would a foreigner be interested in Japanese music?
What's your answer?
Why don't you understand your own music?
It's sad in a way, isn't it, Hiromi-san?
But it is true that young people are changing, and I was going to say that the young Japanese have the same reaction about westernized Japanese music. We find it much easier to understand, right?
Well, anyway, what about future plans, Lynn? Where are you going from here?
I hope to stay in Japan if I can and continue my studies in koto.
But will you not go back to America one day and play the koto in the Japanese embassy in Washington?
At this point, I'm hoping to stay in Japan. Seeing as how I'm studying Japanese music, I think Japan is the place to be.
Oh, indeed. And what do your parents think about that?
I think they've given up hope.
Anyway, we can't let you go, can we, without listening, Hiromi-san, to the koto. So could you play a short piece for us?
Certainly.
Well, Lynn is going to play for us Chidori no Kyoku, which is plover in English.
A plover.
This is a traditional koto piece. And I'm sure you would enjoy it.
Yes, I think so. You know, we've introduced many people, haven't we, Hiromi-san, in this program, who are studying various aspects of Japanese culture. And I think in Lynn's case, we might say that she's, half Japanese, half American. Racially, of course, she was Japanese, or is Japanese, but of course, American by nationality. She became interested in Japanese sound and music, and she's going to pursue it all her life. So here's a fascinating example of a real cross-culture cultural exchange. Yes. We might even say an amalgamation, might we?
Indeed. Mm-hmm.
A meeting of the East and West.
Mm-hmm.
So let's finish our program today by listening to Lin Wakabayashi-san play The Plover. Thank you very much, and from everybody here, it's goodbye until next time.
Goodbye.